how you feel about being able to make a difference in the lives of people that we do in the Urban League. I think there's a personal gratification, and there's a liberation that you feel that you are making a difference in life, you know.
Some have decided to enhance their leadership skills while building character by taking advantage of the Urban League's Summer Work Experience Leadership Program.
As the city does its best to denounce the racial slurs, the Urban League's J.T. McLawhorn says they cut deep.
Students will write and produce a 30-second commercial where they will raise awareness for bullying and gun violence.
Well, when we think of giving around Christmas time, toys and children usually come to mind first, but Columbia's Urban League is wrapping their arms around a different group of people so their holiday can be just as bright.
Besides your donations that keep the Urban League alive, it's helping hands that are at the heart of the organization.
It's just a great thing to be able to come out and work with the Urban League to help these senior citizens.
I think at the end of the journey, you know, people want to reflect whether you're looking through the rear mirror or what you're looking through in life. The lenses that you're going to look back, you want to be able to reflect and say, did I make a difference? So I think it's that personal gratification at the Urban League that you feel that you're making a difference in the lives of others. And that's a rewarding experience.
With a lot of the issues that have gone on in the past, that Columbia Urban League has been a part, if not at the forefront, with some of those issues.
I think everything starts with the leadership. I think that the fact that we've had strong, consistent, strategic leadership that no matter what it is that the community is going through, we're able to morph ourselves to assist with that. And so that's the thing. It's like, you know, some urban leagues are known for giving jobs. Some urban leagues are known for its aging program. Some urban leagues are known for training people. This urban league is courageous enough to do all of those things.
It is our job as urban leaguers to ensure that our young people, our adults, our women, anybody has an opportunity for equal pay, a livable wage, for a job, and not just any job. We don't want to, you know, we don't want to be the ditch digger or the janitor. We're smart enough, we're bright enough to get a job as the engineer, as the mechanical engineer, or as the scientist, or as the doctor, the attorney, you know. There's a plethora of positions and opportunities out there for our young people, but we have to get them trained socially, academically, in order for them to be successful. And that's why the Urban League still stands.
It's an art to learn how to balance policy and political implications in a marketplace with the social and community implications in a marketplace. J.T. McLawhorn merges those well.
Mr. Mack has been here 35 years, and he's been instrumental in getting out in the community and advocating for the underprivileged, the underserved. So I think with the advocacy piece, with meeting with different people who affect change through policy, I think that is something that we have done both on the national and the local level.
I think that had I been part of the Urban League experience when I was a youth, I probably might not have made some of the decisions that I made. I probably might not have hung out with some of the people that I hung out with, and I probably would have did a lot better in school because I would have had the confidence and the self-esteem to know that, you know, my present-day situation doesn't determine, you know, my future.
The Columbia Urban League really is like the other 95 other urban leagues, and that is that they are results-driven
and that they're client-centered. It's drive, it's commitment to community, and it's staff. I've known a number of people who have worked here at the Columbia Urban League, and each and every one of them, there's a thread, there's a common thread that runs through all of them. And what we focus on is the end user. We focus on children, we focus on families, seniors, and we want to make sure that if you come to the Urban League, not only that you get what you pay for, but you get what you need.
I believe that race is still the biggest domestic issue in this country. And I believe that if the Urban League did not exist today, we'd have to invent it. And I believe the Urban League is as American as apple pie and is as necessary now as it was 95 years ago.
One of the things that I'm always interested in, and that is that making sure that young people know the value proposition, the narrative about what it took to get here. That Mildred Love, a great Urban Leaguer, one of the few executives who was an executive at the National Urban League for a number of years under a number of leaders, would always say if the Urban League did not exist, we'd have to create one. And that is because the Urban League serves a purpose.
Somehow the millennials have don't recognize what the sacrifices that their predecessors made in order for them to be where they are. I think they take for granted a lot of things that our ancestors couldn't hardly do. And I think they lack the sense of community and family that their grandmas and grandpapas had. There was a need back then to stick together. There were common goals. I don't know that that's true now. You know, I'm not of that age group, for sure. But I think there is a different sense of what is important now.
It's a sad commentary that young people do not know its history.
And that's not the millennials' fault, I think, you know. Us as parents and maybe grandparents, we wanted so much for our children to have more than we had that we didn't teach them much about where we came from.
My father, being a Southern man, knew what it was like and experienced walking from the Shop Road area side of town through Olympia trying to get to Booker T. Washington High School, and had water balloons thrown on him, had balloons with bleach thrown on him, had rocks thrown at him. They used to have to run to get to school.
I grew up going to black school. The name of my school growing up was Lakeview High School. And so I lived in the part of West Columbia that's called Sugartown. And we went to school with kids from Casey, from the lower part of Lexington County, Dixiana, Pocomo, the other part of Happy Town. So during that part of my life, you know, I was aware of discrimination in a very small way, I believe. But, you know, I was pretty insulated. We were, I think the year before we were desegregated, and half of us went to Brooklyn Casey and half of us went to Airport High School. They had something called school choice. And a few people chose to go to the predominantly white schools, but most of us didn't. But by the time I got to the eighth grade, I think that was 68, they closed my school down. And we all, as I said, went to one or the other of the predominantly white schools. There,
is where I think I really became aware of racism. Like I said, I'm coming from a predominantly black school where we had all black everything. Student body, officers, cheerleaders, homecoming queens, class queens, you know. And down there, we had to really fight to get any kind of positions. I think there was one young lady on the cheerleader squad. And of course, there's many black boys on the, you know, the teams. But sometimes even they didn't get to play as well as they could have played had they been at Lakeview still. I moved from being in classes with all of my peers, when I say peers, I mean black kids my age, to being the only black child in most of my classes. Back then, they had, I think they called them advanced, general, and whatever was under general. And I was always in the advanced classes. And when I think back, I just really wonder now if they just intentionally isolated me. I didn't feel any sense of school pride there. I didn't join a single club. And I just think that had I stayed in an all-black environment, that those things would have changed. I was a really smart kid. They didn't tell me about a single scholarship. And I would have qualified for scholarships, you know, based on my academic record.
Even though you grew up in a segregated society, you had something that was more powerful than the barriers that was there in a segregated society. You had a type of momentum. You had a type of energy. You had a type of determination that segregation could hold you down. I mean, and that was that culture of high expectation, that the support from your family, and particularly from your parents, and from the community as a whole. The National Urban League, historical organization that was started because of the outward migration of African American people around the 1900. African American people wanted to leave. They wanted a better opportunity. And when they relocated to many of the urban communities, they were in a foreign land. They were not familiar. They were in the industrial communities where factories and industry was abound.
Even though they talk about coming out of World War I, World War II, sort of the greatest generation, that generation couldn't be informed and could not have grown without the slave institutions, unfortunately.
They were used to elder culture, so it was a transformation for them. And so many people got lost as they transitioned. And their step, the Urban League, came to its rescue. The Urban League came into existence to help African-American people who were leaving the rural South, going to the industrialized North for better opportunities. And so there was an Urban League that helped prepare a bridge to make that transition possible. So the Urban League is part of the history of African-American people, particularly over the past 100 years when you look at the progress of African-American people. And during those days when the business community was looking for people to work in corporate America, they came knocking at the door of the Urban League, whether it was in Chicago, whether it was in New York, whether it was in Atlanta, whether it was in Cleveland, Ohio, Boston, Massachusetts, Baltimore, wherever. They came to the Urban League because the Urban League was known through its efforts to prepare people for opportunities. The late Whitney M. Young Jr., who was a past president of the National Urban League and a civil rights icon that was very instrumental in the passage of the 1964 Civil Rights Act, made a statement years ago that one of the greatest tragedy in life is not being ready, being prepared when opportunity knocks. So that's what the Urban League does. It prepares people for opportunity. So when you think about the Columbia Urban League, even though we are not 100 years old, we started in 1967. And I think the Urban League has been the heartbeat of our community. I mean, it's not a real high-profile organization, The Urban League spends more of its time in trying to empower people so that they can be able to do for themselves. This is Hurley. This is Alice Hurley and her husband, Mr. Anthony Hurley, were the ones that did not think it was robbery to work day and night to get an Urban League established here in 1967. They were the ones that knew about the great works of the Urban League around the country. They took the leadership role here and said, we need an Urban League in Columbia, South Carolina. In fact, the Urban League in Columbia was the first Urban League established in the state of South Carolina. And, you know, people like to compare us with Charlotte, North Carolina. We had an Urban League here before Charlotte. So, Columbia has been progressive in many ways, particularly in its efforts to bring an Urban League here.
We had offices in Charleston, Greenville, Augusta, satellite offices for one of our programs. So we had a lot of programs, and we had one giant program. We had a lot of people, so many people that we didn't have a meeting space that was large enough to accommodate everyone.
Ms. Alice Hurley is one of two that are still living. She comes to our Equal Opportunity Day dinners every year with her husband. It's amazing to think back, knowing what they saw, what they lived through, and having a desire for something better. And henceforth, here comes the Columbia Urban League. Their initial charter for wanting the Urban League here in Columbia and why it was a necessity. They saw that there were, again, inequalities. And there had to be somebody here to fight the fight. And I think that's what the pioneers were looking for when they set forth and put their charter out for the Columbia Urban League. They wanted someone, and they wanted an agency that was going to work for the people, that was created by people. Because the National Urban League, the same as the Columbia Urban League, had it not been for those people in New York that saw that there needed to be a change, there needed to be a cohesive unit to address the issues and the problems that were going on in society, the National Urban League 104 years ago would not have been founded, and the Columbia Urban League wouldn't have been founded in 1967 by people who saw and knew that there was a change that was needed, and saw that they could be a part of that change. And being a change agent for good is always a phenomenal thing.
Come here and be able to work up under someone such as Ms. Beatrice McKnight or Mr. James T. McLawhorn is a life-changing experience, because some of the knowledge that they impart on you, you know, a lot of things they tell you may already know, but to hear it from someone who's lived through those times and who's seen a lot and who knows a lot. You know, I just really try to be a sponge when I'm around the Mr. McLawhorns or the Beatrice McKnights.
Woman of integrity, courage, and strength. If you don't know the name Beatrice McKnight, you should. The civil rights activist died Monday at the age of 71. She was a woman who never feared anything or anyone, especially when it came to fighting for what she believed was right.
Ms. McKnight is someone that I had the opportunity and the pleasure to work with for years at the Urban League. She was a legendary figure.
A powerful force who dedicated her life to helping others. Beatrice McKnight worked tirelessly to right the wrongs in society. She was a woman who made things happen.
She was a strong advocate for social justice and human rights, and she was there for our children. She loved our children, a very dedicated employee.
What made Mrs. McKnight so impressive was her humility around the significance of what she had done in terms of civil rights. I mean, she was, you know, she wouldn't brag about it or anything. But she was, a real good friend of Majeska Simpkins, who is the most celebrated civil rights icon in South Carolina. So Mrs. McKnight was like a protege of Majeska Simpkins. And so she carried that strength with her. You know, she carried the strength of that. And, you know, it was like, it's part of who she was.
You could not miss her energy, because she was an imposing person, and she didn't mind intimidating you a little bit. But she had a heart of gold and would do anything, loved her people, was totally committed to equal opportunity, would not tolerate any kind of discrimination, and wasn't scared of nobody or nothing to that end. You know, if you wanted somebody fighting for civil rights, then that's who you would want to be by your side.
Ms. McKnight was, she was a sweet lady. She was firm, but she was always fair. You had to know your history when you talked to Ms. McKnight. You couldn't just throw out little tidbits, young man, young lady. Well, where did you learn that? And she wanted to know, because you couldn't just say you knew about the 1960s, or you knew about civil rights, or you knew about the March on Washington. Well, what did you know? Explain it to me. And that's the type of woman Ms. McKnight was. She wanted to make sure all of our young people knew their history.
When she had a special project to do, Christmas giving, any of the other things that she was working on, she would map out a way that she'd make sure she was doing everything that was asked. I guess what I need to say is Beatrice McKnight was on her game all the time. And she was the kind of person that was really no nonsense. And I enjoyed working with Mrs. McKnight. People like Mrs. McKnight helped to give our organization credibility. And not just because she worked here, but because she's associated with the organization, you know?
And we just thank God for the opportunity to work with Mrs. McKnight.
Columbia Urban League, when I think of the Columbia Urban League initially, you always think of J.T. McLawhorn, you know, the longstanding CEO, man of great distinction, not only in the state, but I think movement-wide.
We have a strong concentration on our young people and making sure that they are ready for work, ready for life, ready for college, coming straight out of high school. And our programs are geared toward that, empowering, enriching, uplifting our young people, and we get that from Mr. McLawhorn.
You hear grown folks talking? Be quiet.
No, today we want to hear you talk. Grown folks,
we gotta be quiet today.
Let the young people talk, because it's all about you all. And I want you all to feel that you got something to offer, because you do have so much to offer.
Compassionate, I guess. Because you have to have compassion to be in this line of work for as long as he has.
Mr. McLawhorn particularly is really good with reaching every demographic, but he particularly is skilled in that kind of, that older kind of demographic, and we have people calling about programs we had years ago. He's a person to reference because he's been here for that long, and he's able to give that kind of service and those kind of, that attention that I wouldn't be able to just because he's been here for such a long time. So
I want to just, let's get a shout out to the Urban League staff.
It is an honor to serve. A lot of times people complain about serving. They say, well, you know, I worked here for these years, I've done all of this, and I did this, and I did that. In essence, you know, but it is a privilege. So I see anything that I've been able to accomplish, it has been a privilege, and I'm thankful that God selected me.
From my earliest, I've always known that this has been an affiliate that's been focused on families, on community, and really about the end user, making sure that the services and the staff who provide those services are informed, that they are educated, and that they really have a commitment and a passion to the work that they do.
Warm, friendly, like a second family. Vibrant, it's fast-paced because we're doing a lot with a little bit of staff. So, but everybody works as a team here. You know, so, great staff.
We are energetic at the Columbia Urban League. It's always been that way. It's always been what we need to do, we do. We set a goal and we reach it. It's part of it is because we all believe we can.
It's a place where you can grow and develop as a service provider. And that's the number one intention of the Urban League, to provide services to those people who haven't had the opportunity to, you know, get access to things, educational opportunities, financial opportunities, opportunities to be nurtured and mentored by people who've, you know, had experience in various professions.
Actually, I had a rather unique experience when I joined the Urban League because I was a student over at Benedict College. I was a returning student. I had just come home from the military and was trying to find employment and unsuccessful, and I had someone advocating on my behalf for a position here at the Urban League. I started out as an intern here, and it eventually turned into a permanent staff position, and I guess that was a result of me doing some things right at the time and whatnot. So it's been quite a journey, and I've enjoyed it since being here.
I was actually sent here by God, I feel, because I was at an employment expo at the Koger Center, and after I was leaving, I felt kind of down because I didn't feel like I, you know, was received well by the employees that were there. And then within me, something told me to go to the Columbia Urban League, and I did that and been here ever since.
I actually became involved in the Columbia Urban League when I was in high school. I was a participant in the Summer Work Experience Leadership Program. I actually came through that program. After I did that, I worked for the Youth Development Academy under Ms. McKnight. After that, then I actually came on the staff of the Summer Work Experience Leadership Program, and then I think a year after that, I became the coordinator. So ever since high school.
Over the years, we have had a finite focus in youth development because our young people are our future. The Urban League has a cluster of programs serving young people. We serve young people 10, 11, 12, and 13. We have a program. It's our Youth Development Academy. That's a program that we target years ago because normally during summer months we work with young people who are at least 14 years of age.
In the summer, we have one of the strongest employment components in the state of South Carolina, putting almost 1,000 young people to work during the course of the summer, be it through our college internship program or through our SWELP program, which is our Summer Work Experience Leadership Program, YLDI, Youth Leadership Development Institute, or through YDA, and it's a 10 to 13 year old program. They don't go to work, but it's a summer enrichment camp where they still receive a stipend, keeping our young people busy.
Youth Leadership Development Camp is one of the highlights of the Columbia Urban League. It's an opportunity that we bring together about 250 young people, and we talk with them about life skill development and also prepare them for work experience. And we understand that if young people are going to be successful, we got to prepare them. And if we prepare them and teach them what they need to know, they would have the skill sets to be successful and to be able to address some of the negative peer pressure that people place upon them.
Well, I am the program manager for the Youth Leadership Development Institute, and with that program we serve youth between the ages of 14 to 21 who are in foster care or recipients of DSS services. And since day one when I got here, I was a part of that program. It was recently promoted last year to program manager, but
You know, it's a year-round program. We meet with youth in 9 counties, and we serve about 350 youth. We do independent living skills. This year in September, we added Career Ready 101, which is a preparatory course produced by ACT to prepare them for their Work Key certification. So that makes them more marketable. So we're all about, you know, equipping them with the skills that they're needed to secure employment, education, you know, post-secondary success so that they can make a successful transition into adulthood.
We implemented the college internship program about 10 years ago. And the purpose of this program is to provide career work experience for students in college to connect them with future employers. Really important.
And I am the program coordinator for the Summer Work Experience Leadership Program. And actually this summer I've also kind of dealt with the college internship program. So I'm not sure how familiar you are with the Summer Work Experience Leadership Program, but it's basically a 2-week work experience where students between the ages of 14 and 19 are placed in and around the Columbia area, and they are able to further enrich those kind of fundamental work experience kind of task.
SNAP is Supplemental Nutrition Assistant Program. It pretty much helps. It's a program that feeds individuals that are unemployed or underemployed, low income base. It helps them gain, it pays for grocery or whatever for them because they don't have the cash or funds to do so. So it kind of helps lift the burden.
It really is a lot of work to be able to sustain a program, because when a program is started from national, they may give you funding to start it off. But after those first few years, they kind of back up, and it's on you to sustain it. So a lot of that hard work is coming from, you know, Mr. McLawhorn and program directors like Ms. Dean to go and find grants and meet with different people and community stakeholders and make those connections so they have those liaisons to, you know, keep the program going even after National no longer can fund it. A prime example would be I Am Woman. That's no longer, you know, something that National is going to keep footing for us. So we have to go and find grants and write grants. And writing grants is very time consuming. I've helped Ms. Dean on a couple, but it's very time consuming, very extensive. So being that we're not an affiliate that has somebody that writes grants, you have those program directors who are trying to run programs as well as writing grants at the same time. So it's definitely a lot of work. But like I mentioned earlier, with the Columbia Urban League being, you know, different about the staff here really enjoys what they do, so they make time for it.
Check this out, man. We rolling this way. That march in 1963, that was a bit of nonsense. We ain't rolling like that no more. Matter of fact, the young black America, we rolling up with seminars, press conferences, and straight up rallies. Am I right? We're gonna get what we got to get. Coming to us, word up. We ain't going out like that 63 nonsense.
Playback.
At the forefront of trying to bring the Stop the Violence movement, along with some partners and collaborative efforts from different organizations and agencies in the area to try and bring about a change and whatnot.
We were able to have Stop the Violence clubs all over the city, and we'd have parties, and we would pass out flyers, and the kids would come up and pick up their flyers, take them to their high schools, and the most popular kids were Stop the Violence members. We use the young and gifted as a foundation to invite people to become members, and then anybody who wanted to be, who was in the age group, could be. And we'd have workshops and activities that would empower them.
That's partly one of the reasons why the Stop the Violence movement came about. And during that time, you may not remember, but for those who are along my age line, were born back in the 70s and whatnot, they'll remember looking at rap videos such as the Stop the Violence video with KRS-One and Miss Melody and all of these different rappers like Public Enemy and whatnot that were promoting Stop the Violence in communities and whatnot because it had gotten to an all-time high.
And we have many scholarship programs that we expose young people to. We take them on field trips. As you know, we participate in the National Urban League Youth Conference, and that is a major event. You have about 500 leaders from around the country. Our young people go on an annual basis. We take about 25 young people there. And we've been very successful in those efforts.
Youth Summit is something that the National Urban League has done for years now. If I'm correct, this year would be its 25th anniversary of the Youth Summit. And you're bringing young people together from all of the affiliates across the country, those that have youth programming. And you bring them all together and they get to feed off of one another. And they're networking with each other. And you have adults facilitating some sessions, but to see the light bulbs go off on these kids' heads, it's like boom, 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 all the way around the room. Because what we do here in Columbia, we may do it a little bit different than they do it in Minnesota, or that they do in Ohio, that they do in Florida. So the kids get an opportunity to share what they've done in their own affiliate with someone else from another affiliate. And they're getting ideas, and they're getting opportunities to meet future leaders, because a lot of these kids go on and do some great things, and we don't know it till we come to the Youth Summit again the following year.
The Urban League does, and what Juanita has been able to do, is build around her this sense of community, to build around her this sense of belonging. So people want to come to the Urban League. They want to participate in our programs, and they want to participate for one to two reasons. You have someone who's giving you 179%. Let me say that again. Not 100%, but they're giving you 179%. But they're also giving you 179% of what you need. Not just what you want, but what you need.
Young people must be taught about work. You cannot expect young people to go into the work environment. So we put a lot of emphasis on preparing them for that work experience. And we try to place them in areas where they have a career interest.
This is our fourth annual STEM Expo. Science, technology, engineering, mathematics. We really believe that we're gonna close the achievement gap. Get young people excited about STEM. STEM is so energizing. And today, our students will be exposed to interactive workshops, exhibitors, and it's all designed to get them connected to STEM. Sometimes so many young people are mystified about science, technology, mathematics, and engineering. What we're trying to do is demystify and let them know that STEM is part of your everyday lifestyle.
Today, we think it's important for them to have some experience, develop relationships, develop mentors in the work environment.
To change lives, to transform lives, to equip our youth with the skills and tools needed for them to be successful in society, to be contributing members of society, and to let them know that despite their background, despite what they might have gone through, despite whether they're in foster care, from, you know, a disadvantaged community, you know, that they can make it. You know, it's not how you start, it's how you finish.
The youth get this fundamental experience. They get an opportunity that they otherwise would not receive. The Urban League says, okay, you know what, you need that first experience, but here are these employers who may not feel comfortable And how are they going to get that experience if we don't provide it? You know, they want somebody who has experience, but nobody's willing to give them that initial experience. And we provide that opportunity. We say, you know what, we're going to take you in. We're going to try to make you as competitive and as appealing to the employer as we can, and we're going to give you that first experience. So when you do have another opportunity, you can say, you know what, I did this program, I'm familiar with the workforce, and I'm ready.
And what the Urban League provides is a path for people that is not just as needed as it was in the past, it's more needed than it was in the past.
The Urban League has been for me a place that I have over the course of many years, you know, come into myself more, have gained the greatest amount of confidence. I believe I've had the opportunity to provide very good service for the people that I served. I think I have been a mouthpiece, so to speak, or an example of the good work that the Urban League does in the community.
That we're known for, and then what we're going to do is we're going to add a C element, which is the project. Raise your hand if you were at Think Tank. Okay, so I mean, whoever was involved with Think Tank, whoever's interviewing those people who are going to be on camera, who were at Think Tank, I need y'all to come up with questions for them.
We've done a lot of great things to help them. Think Tank helps us in school. We have two degrees. We had our youth building, which was really great.
Show me some of that box up there.
Juanita Dean-Bates is a recipient of the National Urban League Eddie Moore Caring Adult Award. Bates has been honored going above and beyond to improve the lives of urban youth. Bates challenged her students to take action to transform society by taking them to Washington, D.C., where they took part in the 50th anniversary of the March on Washington.
Project Ready is something that I'm extremely passionate about. And I'm doing what I love to do, working with young people, working with older people. And I found a way to mesh the two. Because through Project Ready, we have to do service learning and things of that nature. My I Am Woman is a health initiative. We had a health fair a couple of months back where the Project Ready kids did the health fair and worked the health fair for the ladies of I Am Woman. And that gives the older adults an opportunity to work alongside young people, and young people the same opportunity to work alongside older adults. My young people are, they're different. There's no two in the program that's alike, really and truly.
My name is Deshaun Felder.
My name is Hezekiah McCoy.
My name is Jalen Johnson.
My name is Jonathan Olson.
My name is Isaiah Stephen Scott.
My name is Brian Hunter.
Nigel Smith.
Madison Dice.
Brandon Dill.
Christasia Townsend.
Name's Elijah Frederick.
So I'm working with different personalities, and what I do is, what do you want to do? What do you want to see come out of the program? What is it that you want? Because it's not my program. There's benchmarks that we have to meet for the National Urban League and Department of Justice, who is the funder for this program, but it's theirs. Tell me what you want to do, and let me see how I can tailor that to the benchmarks that we need to meet. Because if it's not something that the kids want to do, guess what? They won't show up. They just won't. So when you think about the things that we have done in Project Ready, the kids wanted to have a dance. Well, I'm sorry, I'm not doing a dance. No, I don't do dances. It has to have a purpose. So we came up with the cotillion at the end of the year.
We had our cotillion and we waltzed. I've never done nothing like that before. I actually opened up and expressed myself to other people. I usually don't do that because I'm a quiet and shy person.
Well, the cotillion, that was fun, but it took a lot of work to get it done, and it took a lot of aggravation, but at the end, we always made Ms. Dean proud, and we had it right for her. Well, it was fun how I learned new dances and things like that. Man, I just had fun enjoying doing it.
Not only is it an opportunity for them to dress up, because my young men have tuxedos, my young ladies wear gowns, not cocktail dresses, gowns, floor length. Because they need to understand that this is a night of elegance. To see the look on their face when they got it. To see the look on the parents' faces when they saw, oh my goodness, that's my child, is awesome. But it was also an opportunity for the young people to show off what they've learned. So that was the cotillion. It's at the end of the year, and it culminates with everything that we have done during the course of the year. Because we have to emulate what we want the children to become. So I like having the college students come and work hands-on with the kids as well. And the parents, there's a parent component that, you know, if we don't have parent support, if we don't have that parental support, then our program wouldn't be as successful as it is.
It makes a difference when, especially when the parents get together, because we can share information amongst each other and what may be helpful for my child that my child does not need. Your child may need that information, so we can share information.
The parents have brought into the program, the young people have brought into the program. We have mentors who believe in it and are working with the young people. So it is really a family, and it has its own little compartments. And we don't always get along, just like families. And there's some bumps and bruises in the road, but at the end of the day, it's all for the better good. And the better good is for our young people.
Well, it's basically like a family here with Ms. Dean being the matriarch.
Ms. Dean is like a second mom to me. She looks out and she takes care of all of us like we're hers.
And Ms. Dean is a very good person as well to me, because she acts like a second mom to me when I come here, and she makes sure I stay on the right track, able to do good in school.
She was just one of the most recognized people that I've seen, because as soon as I came in, she showed love and affection and didn't waste no time showing me how much she cared about my future and how things were going with my life. And at the same time, she showed that no-nonsense, play-around type.
A parent, a mother to me, because anytime I call her, anytime she answers the phone, she's a very good role model for all the teens.
Ms. Dean is like a second mother to almost everybody in Project Ready. She's just a cool person, and she's easy to get along with.
And she really acts accordingly, you know. She's very fair, but there's like a discipline that she has, and she forces that with all of her students really well.
Having a second family, I know what it feels like to have sisters, have brothers. The upsides are we can laugh, we can joke with each other. The downsides where we fight and get on each other's nerves. It's everything that you want in a good functional family.
Dean, she is in the process of adopting me. So for someone that I have not known but for like 4 years, to be able to extend that to me, I feel like I have come from a rough past. So to me, it's a statement that she genuinely cares. She says all the time that when I say these are my kids, I mean these are my kids. So we're not just someone that she's trying to tell us what to do, or that she's trying to just like, oh, you need to do this in order to be successful. Like, she's there. You can call her any time of the night, 12 o'clock at night. I've had people call her in the middle of the morning. You can go to her office, you can vent to her about anything, and she just listens, she understands. She'll give you advice if you want it, like, she's there. With the graduations, she went to everyone's graduation. you have a school event, you want her there, she's there. She even does pop-ups. Like, I feel like we need more people like her, and especially in our generation, in our lifetime, because a lot of us don't have people that truly care. So to have someone that's there, that's always there for you no matter what, it shows a different type of love that a lot of us are not used to.
I am so pleased with the outcome, with the mentors, with Miss Dean. Oh my gosh, she is absolutely wonderful, you know, with the kids and helping them to reach their goals, give them the resources they need in order to be successful in life.
The first mentee I had, I won't say her name, but she was one of the ones that was a bit more reserved and didn't really like to, you know, get to know new people. But for some reason, she opened up to me. She was Miss Dean's mentee at the time. But as we all know, Miss Dean has her hands full. Like, everybody's her mentee. So Miss Dean matched me to her, and we got really close. And I think just making any kind of personal connection you can with somebody, no matter how you make it or, you know, what you benefit from it, it has an effect that each person in the situation is progressing and is growing because you're learning from them and they're learning from you.
And I went to my first project ready meeting. I really didn't know what to expect. I seen a lot of new faces, met a lot of new people, seen a lot of new mentors and stuff like that. So I was just expecting great things to happen.
I've noticed how, like, everyone is friendly and fun here, and also how it gives back to the community.
Was something that we can relate to, as well as letting it be an open and a free environment to tell how we feel about topics that, you know, some people might be feeling a little iffy about talking about. And it's just a free environment. It's really refreshing how we can open up and be ourselves in here.
I mean, as a mentor, it got to come from the heart. It has to come from the heart. And so pretty much for me, it's satisfaction. You know, knowing that the kids understand or got a relationship with you. And once you build a relationship, then you can teach them and show them what needs to be done, how you did it, what you didn't do, what you should have did. Then after that has happened, then you see the progress, and that's when the satisfaction comes.
Mentors, to me, I feel like they bring a closer connection. They aren't too old, they aren't too young. They're like in our generation. So not only is it just, they're not our age, but they're close enough to our age to be able to relate to what we're going through. A lot of people in the older generations, they don't understand because things were different in their time. And in our time, things have changed so much with social media and technology and what we have to deal with in school. It's so different. So for someone who has been through it and is still being able to give back, I feel like our mentors are being able to give our kids a chance. I know two people in Project Grady. They have tremendously improved since they have gotten with their mentors. So I feel like everybody needs some type of guidance. Everybody needs some type of person that they can go to, that they can depend on. And if that mentor is that person, then let them be that person.
My college students bring a whole new quote-unquote flavor to the room when they're in there, and sometimes I leave, you know, and let the young people do the session on whatever it is, whatever topic it is for that day, because they'll get a little bit more from it from a college student than he would from me.
And I'm extremely proud of my graduating seniors. You guys are getting ready to embark on a whole nother level. You will be given the opportunity to learn, to meet people from all over the country based on the schools that you go to. Make sure that the decisions that you make reflect who you are. Don't let your decisions be those of someone else. Chart your path and just keep walking.
It's just exciting to see it finally come to an end, just knowing that one day we're actually going to look back at this and just be like, dawg, it was amazing.
I think it's great, man. It really helped me when I was graduating, getting ready to graduate. So it's a good program to empower youth and get them to look look forward to the future, you know what I'm saying? Like, get ready for the next grade and beyond high school. So that's, I think it's a great program.
I think it's a great program to help the kids as far as their future goals, whether it's college, going to the military, finding a trade. It's a good way to help kids stay out of trouble and further their educational goals.
A lot of community service and everything. Yeah, you get to spend time with people you just know. You get to make new friendships, and it's kind of like you get to listen and do work activities, fun stuff, and you get to go play.
For those who I will see in a short 2 months, 2.5 months, we will be in the great city of Cincinnati at Xavier University, and you all will hang out with me, and we will do some STEM stuff and have a great time on campus. But for today, I'm here to honor you and to celebrate you. Parents, celebrate your young people, because this is just a step along their journey. And for the mentors who we are definitely here to see and recognize, we are happy to see you face to face and know that you all are making an impact. One of the things also that the National Urban League believes in is that it takes one caring adult outside of their parent to help make a change in a child's life. And we thank you greatly for being that change in their lives and being that person who says, you can do this. So to all of you all, congratulations, and I look forward.
My gist for them was that they can do anything and become anything, but most importantly, in this day and age, with technology being the way that it is that there's nothing that they cannot become right now. They don't have to wait for a time frame to happen and go beyond. And to also remember that this may be the only time somebody pats them on the back, and that they need to take it seriously and want it more, but that these are times that, for right now, the world is embracing them. You're young, they're going to embrace you.
You get them as freshmen, try to stay until they're seniors. Be there the day they graduate, so they will know you've been a big part of my life.
What I see mostly, and I see it across the board with all Urban League kids, is that they have this sense of camaraderie, this sense of family, this sense of unity, and they will support one another. Some of the kids left and did what they had to do, but the rest of them, when it came down to the talent, stayed and showed support. So they're very supportive of one another, and they will get at you just like family. They may not be related by name, birth, or anything, but they are like family, and they are such a supportive group.
It was a humbling experience, because it was like, wow, like I went from handing in a resume trying to volunteer, and now, you know, I've watched these students grow from, you know, they may have made the milestone from middle school to high school, or from high school to going to college, some military, so it's definitely like, wow, time is passing us by.
Project Ready is an organization basically that defines everything that you're not good at. From what I've seen, it basically takes whatever that's not your strong point and it turns it into your strong point. I was already a talkative person. I came in here ready to go. Started off a little slow, you know, just getting a feel for the environment, but that's anybody. But then it showed me how to be a leader more, take charge, do more things actively, help other people's, and that's just my gift.
I mean, the legacy speaks for itself. I mean, they do plenty of things in the community. Been doing plenty of things in the community, you know. So, I mean, in this documentary, it's just pretty much giving people another side to the Urban League than they see, because all they see is Mr. McLawhorn, you know, or, you know, the Columbia Urban League, do one thing in the community. But the documentary really gives them a background of what really goes on in the Urban League, so, I mean, and what has happened in the Urban League.
Probably, without Urban League, I probably wouldn't have been the same person, because I wouldn't have been able to get those experiences that I have gotten to grow and become who I am today. Like, even in one of my essays for Gates, like, it was talking about how Urban League has helped me and how I have helped it. So Urban League in itself is really great. And even just from the people at my school, I've heard the students, like, they want to know, like, how do I get involved, or how do they get involved with Urban League? They want to be a part of it as well.
I think it's impacted my life because it gave me something to stand for. It gave me something to be able to say that I am a part of something, and I'm not just sitting around wishing something would change, looking at the news, complaining about it, and not being active about it. The league is more than just jobs. It's more than just kids getting together and talking. Like, we're hands-on, we're active, we're out there. We're making a move with our marches, signs we make when we, even within ourselves, we talk to each other. We have heart-to-heart talks about things that we go through that a lot of people may not think that we do have to deal with, and we do. And to be able to uplift one another, I think it's, like, incredible. So for me, it's impacted my life in more than just a positive way, and, like, I would say extraordinary, but maybe even better than that.
What do I want the community to know about the Columbia Urban League's legacy? That it's rich, that it is built on a foundation of the backs of those who came before us, who made it so that we could have the education, the jobs, the finances, the nice houses, the nice cars. That the Columbia Urban League is here to empower its young people to be the next kings and queens in our society, to be the next Barack Obama, to be the next Charles Bolden, you know, to be, just to be whoever it is that they want to be, but to be the best in it. And that's why the Columbia Urban League still stands, because our mission is not done. There's still young people out there that need to be touched. There's still work to be done. Mr. McLawhorn says that this is a mission. We are called by God to do the things that we do. And I truly believe that, because this is not work for the faint at heart. You have to want to do what we do here. 365 days a year. Yeah, we have those occasional days off, and we close down a couple of days for Christmas. But I am here to tell you, the Columbia Urban League staff is constantly giving back to this community. And we don't do it for praise. We don't do it for recognition. We do it because we have a leader who has instilled and has empowered us to be able to go out into the community and give back. And I can only give what was given to me. And that's why I find this job so rewarding and so easy. You're welcome.